Now that Donald Trump gets to stack the Supreme Court with conservative judges, pro-corporate judges, individuals who are likely to strike down the Affordable Care Act, many Americans are rightly concerned about losing health care coverage if they have pre-existing conditions. For all the flaws that the Affordable Care Act has, and we've discussed them at length, there were some certain protections through the Affordable Care Act that are important, protections for pre-existing conditions. It's not talked about a lot, but it also helped to expand Medicaid programs on a state level, which would then help to ensure that people living in poverty would have healthcare coverage. All of that is really under threat now. And so Erik Erikson chimed in on this debate and said the following: "I don't think the government should force coverage for pre-existing conditions. I think it is bad policy that will lead to increased healthcare costs and diminish the need for personal responsibility." Erik Erikson is a trash human being. Because healthcare is not supposed to be a commodity. And to make this ridiculous, simplistic argument that we can keep healthcare costs low simply by focusing on what individuals can do on an individual level is stupid. It's stupid. No one decides or chooses to get cancer.
Right.
You know, it's just, anyway.
No matter how much personal responsibility you exercise, like, you could get, I don't know, some disease that I probably never even heard of. It just, sometimes there's just bad luck. So no amount of personal responsibility can account for that. But Erik Erikson is an interesting figure in American politics, because I remember on TYT maybe a couple weeks ago, we talked about that staffer who was just kind of honest about it was like a staffer for like a North Carolina guy who just said, like, yeah, no, if you don't have health insurance and you have cancer, like, yeah, you should die and you can't afford it, yeah, sorry, you should die.
Yeah,
you know, they commit the sin, the biggest sin in American politics, which is just telling the truth. And that's the truth.
Honesty.
He's being honest about his views. But Erik Erikson in particular is the almost perfect example of a trend that has happened in the last 10 or so years that Alex Perrine talks about a lot, which is that in the past, the sort of denizens of the Republican Party, the sort of leaders of the Republican Party, kind of understood that, you know, they needed to feed red meat to the rubes every once in a while to keep them, like, whipped up and voting Republican. But really all they cared about was, like, lowering capital gains taxes and doing wars abroad and stuff. And, like, all these kind of hot button social issues, like, they to themselves didn't really believe it. They read the Wall Street Journal. They didn't listen to right wing talk radio, like, which was, like, for the crazies and for the rubes. At one point, roughly around 10 years ago, roughly around when the Tea Party came about, the sort of inmates took over the asylum, so to speak, and those people, the rubes, are now the people in power in the Republican Party. And Erik Erikson, the transition that he did from, like, Red State, when he was, like, the editor of Red State, which at the time was seen as, like, this, like, crazy right-wing blog, to being a CNN... on CNN, like, he was a CNN contributor. This was, like, they hired him kind of to be, like, the Tea Party guy, you know, and at the time it was seen as, like, this crazy hire, you know, like, now all the Republicans, like, even, like, all of them are Erik Erikson's, you know, like, that transition has been fully complete.
No, I love that you brought that up. That's such a good point. And, I mean, if you look at the other side, if you look at true, like, leftists, how many leftist contributors does CNN have?
No, none.
I mean, it was
zero.
It was when Bernie was still in the, you know, when the primaries were happening, he was still had a good chance of winning the primaries.
Yeah.
Chris Cuomo was the only one who ever brought either me or Cenk onto a show to make a robust case for Bernie. And I give him credit for that. But that was the exception, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I haven't seen a progressive or a leftist.
You'd think from, like, a cold capitalist point of view, they would recognize, like, go look at all these people. They love Bernie. We need some Bernie people to talk. Maybe we'll get them to tune in every once in a while. And, like, no, it's like, it's so outside of their... Like, they just don't even consider it. It's like as if it didn't exist. No. It's crazy.
Yeah, it is crazy. And for me, there's just this, on every major issue that really has like a fundamental negative impact on our lives, right? We keep hearing this argument, not just from right wingers, by the way, I hear it from liberals as well, this notion of personal responsibility. The climate issue, liberals pushed personal and continued to push personal responsibility, as opposed to keeping corporations that have contributed the most to climate change accountable for their actions, right?
Right.
So, you know, we're sucking our cocktails through paper straws that disintegrate in like 2 seconds because we're doing our part for the environment. Yeah. But at the same time, you have Gavin Newsom signing new permits for fracking in the state of California. It's infuriating.
It's a great point. I mean, I hadn't really thought of it that way, but it really is just the other side of the same coin. It's you know, yeah, it's meatless Mondays. It's recycling, which turns out to be a giant scam, apparently. It's all pushing it onto the individual rather than looking for actual collective solutions that change the distribution of power. No, it's exactly. That's a good point.
And it's and when you really like put it in context, it's even worse because we subsidize these industries, which then turn around and destroy the environment. We have to pay the costs of this destroyed environment, right? Like we have to deal with the ramifications while they've made their profits. And then on top of that, the onus is on us, right? Like, oh, would you look at that? Climate change is real. We need to do something. No more, you know. And by the way, I'm fine with banning plastic bags and plastic straws.
Yeah.
But my issue is that the onus seems to always 100% be on us as individuals, when in reality, the people in positions of power who have, taken advantage of the environment and have taken advantage of this commodified healthcare model, you know, they're off the hook. We don't have to worry about them. It infuriates me. And one other example of that, real quick, was this tweet by New York Times Business. John Mackey, John Mackey, the founder of Whole Foods, blames obesity on bad decisions by consumers rather than lack of access to healthy food. And here's a quote. It's less about access and more about people making poor choices, mostly due to ignorance.
The rubes, you know, they're just too ignorant. They like their Hot Pockets and their McDonald's and they're just all fat and gross since they just shopped at Whole Foods and gotten, vegan matcha tea or whatever, like they'd be better off.
If they only spent $25 on a canister of pre-cut cucumber in cucumber water, then they would be okay. They're just ignorant. That's the problem.
They're just ignorant. Yeah. I mean, it's just but it's like that it's been absorbed because it's been beaten down into us since we were little kids, right? That this idea, it's such a deep part of the American psyche, I find. It's just and it's like, and it kind of translates it when it kind of gets burrowed inside of you, it translates into like a form of self-loathing that I find, you know, to be very and they love that. They instill that upon you. Like if you're fat, it's just because you're disgusting, gross, you know, person who doesn't know that you should be doing healthier life choices. It's like, no, that's just not how that works. There's big collective solutions to the obesity problem. You know, there's things that can be done. Not just like shame people for liking McDonald's, you know?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, how about we look into why it is that the United States is particularly unique in obesity and all of these problems, and what are other countries doing correctly? Like, there's this very active effort to prevent Americans from doing any type of comparative analysis between our system and systems in other countries. I think it's because we're not the best. We are messing up in a number of different areas. And in order to actually do things correctly, we need to challenge capital. We need to challenge people in positions of power. We need to challenge this entire system. And we're getting a little taste of what that looks like when you want to do something as mild as demand that police officers stop shooting and killing people on the streets. You know, it's like, hey, maybe we don't want to live in a society with extrajudicial killings. And, you know, people's heads explode.
Yeah.
It's pathetic.